experience of working in Amitabha Hospital, Cochin, where I started up its own clinic. It's called as Tiny Hearts Fetal Cardiac Clinic and Heart Hospital of Women and Children in Tanjavur. Sir is the son of the stalwart in pediatrics, Dr. M. Singaravelu, a known personality among our pediatric fraternity. Sir has cardiac experience of more than 8 years and many publications, and he has indexed journals. Sir has also been author many chapters in various cardiac books. Sir has given a lot of hope to many children with a hole in the heart by conducting various free camps. So we very applaud your efforts, sir, and we are looking forward now to listen to your interesting talk. Over to Mahiram Krishna.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to the organizers of Edicon for having given me this opportunity to talk about Syncope. I think this is a good talk to give given the theme of the conference, which is resurrecting clinical pediatrics. And Syncope is one condition where the clinical examination, your history and physical examination, is the most important part of evaluation. So I'm going to keep this talk entirely clinical. I'm going to use case scenarios to get to my point. Before I go to the scenarios, just a few basic information about syncope. So the word syncope essentially comes from the Greek word syncopin, which means to cut short. And by definition, it's a transient and self-limited loss of consciousness. But the most important point about syncope is that its recovery should be spontaneous, it should be pretty quick, and should be complete. There should not be any neurological deficit after they recover from the event. And there are many causes of syncope, but the final common pathway towards syncope is a decrease in the amount of cerebral blood flow. So the amount of cerebral blood flow drops to less than 50% of the baseline blood flow. So, a lot of us may wonder whether syncope is really a common problem in children. The truth is it's a very common problem. So I would say up to 15% of all children will have had at least one episode of syncope during childhood. And looking at data from all over the world, up to 1% of emergency visits in pediatrics is due to syncope. So it is indeed a common problem. So if you want to look in detail about the cause of syncope, I would suggest that you go and look at this this article which we wrote in the Indian Journal of Practical Pediatrics. But essentially, there are only three broad groups causing syncope. The first and the largest chunk is neurocardiogenic syncope, or what we commonly refer to as vasovagal syncope or benign syncope. But up to 20% can be due to significant causes, and the most common of these is cardiac. Of course, there will be some causes which we cannot fit into these three modules, but these are extremely rare. So all of us, we will immediately have this question. Is there a stepwise evaluation for syncope? Is there a way in which, in sitting in my clinic or sitting in the emergency room of my hospital, I can differentiate whether this child has had a simple pain or a cardiac cause of pain? It actually is very simple. All it needs is for us to evaluate the history and the examination in a systematic way and to look for red flag signs. So I'll start with a case. So this was a 9-year-old boy who presented to me with the first episode of syncope. So he was playing a football match in the PT period in school. Then at the end of the PT period, all the boys went together. They were drinking water when suddenly the other students noticed the noise and found that he had fallen on the floor. So he recovered on his own within a few seconds. And he was fully conscious, there were no injuries at all. So he was brought to us by the school teacher. So this is how we ask the history in any child who presents to us with syncope. We look at these five important points and we try to document it in every single child who presents to us with syncope. So they are the time of the event, the posture at which they were there before the event, and we try to get the onlookers, whether it's the parents or whoever was there during the event, to describe it in their own words. And we look for any injuries during the fall and the time it takes to recover. So for this child, it was at the end of the PT period. It was not when he was playing. It was only after he finished playing and he was walking to drink water that he fell down. He was upright and he had been running for an hour before the event. So the other students who looked at it, they said he slouched and he fell on the bench behind. He just didn't collapse completely. He did not sustain any injuries and his recovery was within in less than a minute. So these to me suggest that the event is not a malignant cause of syncope. So then I went back and got some history from the child. So what he described to me was he felt some blurring of vision, and then he didn't recollect anything. He only recollected waking up and being surrounded by his teachers and his friends. He does not have any recollection about the fall, but he does remember that he had blurring of vision before the before he lost consciousness, and that is a very important feature to differentiate benign and malignant causes of syncope. Now he was perfectly okay, and he does not recollect having something similar in the past. Now, an hour later, the parents arrived after the school had informed them, and they confirmed that there was no significant medical illness that the child had. But they also told us some very important facts. They said that they had gone to a movie the previous night and had returned very late, so the boy had woken up late and he had skipped breakfast and gone to school. His physical examination was completely normal. And based on just the history and examination, we were able to conclude that this was a benign syncope, a vasovagal syncope. So what are the key elements which helped us decide that this was benign and not malignant? The main thing, as I said, is the time of the event. And the next thing is the activity leading to the event. So here, the syncope occurred not when he was exerting himself, but after he had completed the exertion. So if he had fainted while playing football, then you have to think of a cardiac cross primarily. But this particular child did not faint while playing. So it was only after the activity was completed that he fainted. And this is a very typical history in vasovagal syncope. So I quite often get referrals saying syncope on exertion, when very clearly, if you ask a detailed history, the syncope happened after the exertion. And it is important to try to differentiate these two points by asking a detailed history. It is also important to look for associated symptoms. The most important symptoms I look for are history of palpitation, history of breathlessness on exertion, and previous history of syncope. And if any of these history is present, then you will have to take it more to be more significant. And another important point in the history is the posture at the time of event. With vasovagal syncope or neurocardiogenic syncope, the syncope always occurs in a standing position. So if the child is not standing at the time of the event, then you will have to take it as something other than vasovagal syncope, and you will have to evaluate the child in detail. It's also important to ask for family history. The specific family history which we look for are history of syncope in family members, history of sudden unexpected death, and history of seizures in multiple family members. So with neurocardiogenic syncope, as I mentioned in this case, I kept stressing on the blurring of vision. Almost every single case will have a prodrome followed by loss of consciousness and then complete recovery, usually within seconds. And the prodrome is usually a dizziness or blurring of vision. So if you carefully ask the child, you know, most of these neurocardiogenic syncope occur in slightly older children, usually around 5 to 15 years of age. And if you ask the child, every child will be able to recollect some kind of prodromal syndrome before the loss of consciousness. And if you go back and ask a detailed history, you will either identify a trigger or a precipitant in every single case of neurocardiogenic syncope. A trigger is an event which had happened that day or in the previous few days, which sort of makes it more likely that the child will faint. And the common triggers you find are dehydration, hunger, a recent viral illness, or specifically during the pandemic time, increased screen time. This is something which I see very commonly. Now, we keep on stressing about, you know, screen time of only less than 2 hours. But an average child has a screen time of at least 10 to 12 hours during this pandemic time where they cannot go out and play, and they are confined to their house, and they don't even have school. And this is a very important trigger for neurocardiogenic syncope. There are also precipitants. These are the events which bring about the acute episode of fainting. And those are prolonged upright posture. So a child standing in a prayer meeting for more than half an hour suddenly faints. Then cough and any nauseous stimuli, especially in hospitals, this is not uncommon, where when you prick a child for blood, or even if you prick the child's sibling for the blood, the child sees the blood and faints immediately. any sudden change of posture, that is what you typically see early in the morning when the child gets up from bed and immediately jumps up and then faints while walking to the toilet or walking out of the room. And emotional stresses, especially in adolescents and teenagers, can result in syncope. And if you ask a careful history, in every single case of vasovagus syncope, you will be able to identify a trigger of resistance. Whereas you will not be able to identify a clear-cut trigger of resistance in non-vasovagal syncope or cardiac syncope. So the management of vasovagal syncope is essentially reassurance, pointing out the triggers and resistance, and advising lifestyle modifications so that these particular triggers and resistance are avoided. Two things which I recommend are increased water intake. So I use this rule of 1 liter for every 20 kilos and make sure that the child has at least that much of water every day as a minimum. And the second thing which I keep on insisting is to add some extra salt to the child's diet alone. And parents actually come back and tell me, sir, since you told that he's actually eating much better than what he was, that's because children like the extra salt in their food. And if this doesn't work, very rarely we might have to teach them exercises to improve calf muscle tone. I'll say less than 0.5% of vasovagus syncope tends to recur despite these lifestyle modifications. And in these cases, you might need to start them on either some drugs or some advanced management for vasovagus syncope. And that is the point when you will have to send him to a specialist to manage this child. But I would say more than 99%, you should be able to manage only with these lifestyle modifications. Now, are all cases going to be vasovagal in your practice? Clearly no. And I'm going to illustrate that with another case scenario. This was a 9-year-old girl who was referred from neurology, where he had been evaluated for recurrent syncope. He had previously been diagnosed by an adult neurologist to have complex partial seizures because there were some non-specific EEG changes. And she had been on anti-epileptics for more than 2 years. But because the episode recurred despite adequate therapy, she was referred to a pediatric neurologist. But the neurologist was not able to fit it into an epilepsy syndrome based on his clinical examination, as well as his review of all the EEGs which had been performed. And he wanted to make sure that there was not some other cause explaining the syncope. So when we saw the child, we again went through the same process of a detailed history. And even though the parents couldn't recollect the first few episodes which occurred close to 2 years back, they were able to vividly recollect the last few episodes which had occurred in the preceding months. And each of these episodes was associated with expression. So the mother clearly said that there was one episode where she had asked her to carry the laundry basket up the stairs. She had run up the stairs with the basket and then collapsed. Whereas there was another episode where she was involved with a pillow fight with her elder sibling. So they were really hitting each other madly when she suddenly fainted on the bed. So each of these episodes happened when she was exerting to the maximum. There was no contributory family history, but when we examined her, there were clear signs to point to a cardiac cause of syncope. So her pulse rate was normal and her BP was normal. But she had a grade 2 parastinal heel. She had epigastric pulsation. She had a single and palpable pulmonary component of the second heart sound. And she had other signs of right heart failure. So this was the ECG. I'm going to quickly interpret it for one of time. So you can see that this is sinus rhythm. The heart rate is not very high. But what is very significant is that there is evidence of right ventricular hypertrophy and right ventricular strain. So I'm not able to point it out very well, but in lead D1, you can see that the R wave is pretty tall and there is ST depression, which is a sign of right ventricular strain. And so this child actually had severe pulmonary arterial hypertension, which resulted in the recurrent episodes of syncope. So however, even though it may not be possible to diagnose the exact cause of syncope, it is very much possible to conclude that this syncope is not benign based on only your history and physical examination. And these are the red flag signs which I look for in every child with syncope. So the first, as I mentioned, is syncope on expression. And I'm stressing this point again because this is the most important differentiating point. So the syncope has to happen on what we call mid-stride or during the peak of exertion. It should not happen after the exertion is completed. If that is the case, then it is more likely to be vasovagal syncope. Whereas if it happens during the peak of exertion, it is almost always cardiac syncope. There will never be a prodrome in any of the malignant causes of syncope, and especially cardiac syncope. So if there is a clear recollection of a prodrome such as dizziness, then it is not cardiac syncope. Any syncope which occurs in a posture other than upright posture, think of a more malignant cause. And known heart diseases, it's a no-brainer, it could be related to the primary heart condition. But another very important point, and I'm going to stress it again with another case example, is family history. So it's important to ask for family history of sudden death, any heart problems in relatives, as well as family history of deafness and drowning related deaths. On physical examination, yes, tachycardia, tachypnea, irregular heart rate, any murmurs which is there, and callous rhythm. So what are the common cardiovascular causes of syncope? We divide them into three big causes. The first is electrical or arrhythmias. So there can be inherited arrhythmias, there can be tachycardias as well as bradycardias. You also have mechanical causes such as outflow tract obstruction. So either you have aortic stenosis or severe pulmonary stenosis. And the last is coronary problems, the most common of which you would see is Kawasaki disease. So all of these conditions have one thing in common. The cardiac output is compromised. So with arrhythmias, the heart rate is so high that the heart is not able to pump enough blood out. Whereas with obstruction, aortic stenosis or pulmonary stenosis, there is a fixed resistance against which the heart is not able to pump blood out. And with coronary complications, there is not enough blood going to the heart per se. So each of these conditions are because the heart is not able to pump out enough blood to the brain. So I'm going to have one last case scenario to demonstrate, again, the importance of family history in such cases. So this was an 8-month-old child who presented to us with recurrent syncope, non-consanguineous marriage, but there was a very striking family history. And this is the child's pedigree. I insist on getting a 3-generation pedigree in every single child with syncope who presents to me. And here, as you can see, so the grandparents of this child on the father's side had 7 children, but the father was the only one who was alive at 25 years of age. All of the others had either died in childhood or when they were in any adult. The father was not able to recollect the exact events, but this is very unusual. It's not something which you see in a regular pedigree. And even in this particular family, they had one child who had died suddenly at 3 years and 2 late trimester abortions. These are not like your abortions at 2 months or 3 months, that there's a missed period and then they abort early. So those are usually not related to cardiac causes. But if you have recurrent late trimester abortions, your second or third trimester, then think of cardiac causes. So the examination was normal, but because the history was so striking, we immediately got an ECG. And this child ECG had significant bradycardia and a very abnormal T wave with a prolonged QT interval. So the QT interval, the normal is usually 450, and this child's QT interval was actually 580 milliseconds. And the father also had a similar abnormality on his ECG. So actually this child had long QT syndrome, which we are able to diagnose by genetic testing. And when we started on appropriate therapy for the same, the syncope episodes stopped and he's been doing fine for the last 2 years. So what are the clinical pointers here to think of an inherited cause of syncope? So usually it's family history of sudden infant death syndrome or any sudden death in young family members, somebody less than 35 years of age, don't dismiss this as heart attack. That could be potential familial causes for this. Any difficult to control seizures where the EEG is recurrently normal or where the neurologist is not able to fit it into a particular epileptic syndrome, think of cardiac causes. It might be that the heart rate was so high that the child had decreased blood flow, which manifested as seizures. And again, as I mentioned, syncope on expression, and sometimes even unusual bradycardia in a child, could potentially be related to a malignant cardiac cause. So the tripod for evaluation of syncope is essentially three things: a good clinical examination, a detailed history, and when there is any doubt in these two, get an ECG. So with these three investigations, you'll be able to pinpoint the exact cause in close to 100% of children who present with syncope. I don't know if there are any photographers here, but you'll know that even if one leg of the tripod is weak, your tripod is going to break. And so it is important that you spend time and effort to collect details of all three legs before concluding on the cause of syncope. So a detailed history, a physical examination, and an ECG. And today, Sarah, even if you don't know to interpret ECG, it's very easy to send the ECG by WhatsApp to an expert who can give you the conclusion. So I'll rush on the slides for want of time. Actually, you might wonder, you know, this is all good for theory. How good is it in practice? And there are actually studies showing that if you do this appropriately, you'll be able to identify cardiac syncope in 100% of cases. A detailed history, physical examination, and an ECG will help you identify 100% of cardiac syncope. It might be that you might mistake a few benign causes of syncope for cardiac, but you will not miss any malignant cause of syncope. So I'll come to my last slide. Just two or three carry-home messages which I want to deliver. Syncope is not uncommon in children. And this is something which, you know, adult cardiologists will hear from their teachers. The only difference between syncope and sudden death is that the patient wakes up in one and the patient does not wake up in another. So if you have a child who has recovered from syncope, you are presented with an opportunity to prevent sudden death in this child. So they don't take it lightly. Make sure that you do a detailed evaluation. And that evaluation is not some fancy investigation. It is only a focused history and a complete clinical examination, aided by an ECG when in doubt. Neurocardiogenic syncope is the commonest, yes, but then cardiac syncope is a significant chunk. It can be as much as 5% of all the syncope who come to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your excellent lecture. You covered very well for how to diagnose the syncope. Is it necessary to do all the syncope for aortic? You're not covered. Sometimes any patient will come to you, they keep on asking us for the reason for the disease. Why my child had a syncope? So that the first case you told the child when the play of had a water then within for a syncope attack. Sometimes congenital aortic stenosis also can do like that, isn't it?
Sir, in aortic stenosis, the syncope would have occurred while playing, sir, not after playing. And you will have definite, on examination, the child will not be normal. So you will have a clear-cut murmur, sir. Yes, if they get referred to me, I need to do an echo for completion. But at a primary level, echocardiogram is not necessary to differentiate a malignant syncope from a benign syncope. It's all history and examination. So at the end of the history, you will be able to conclude almost always. And at the end of examination, you should be able to conclude, even if you don't know the cause, whether it is benign or malignant, it is very simple to conclude.
Thank you. Okay, we're open for, let's open for discussion. Both lectures. Any questions?
Any questions from the audience are invited.
Dr. Gurdegiri, sir.
Normally, after syncope, sometimes EEG is recommended by the neurologist. Some abnormalities may be seen. How to differentiate?
And again, sir, you have to go back to the history only.
And any associated symptoms during the syncopal attack, like passing urine, incontinence.